Warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Ocean Voice X Embryo Talk series presented by Faculty of Fisheries and Marine Science, IPB University. We would like to express our heartfelt gratitude to the Dean of Faculty of Fisheries and Marine Science, Professor Dr. Ferdinand Yulianda, Honorable the research team from Wageningen University and Research, Dr. Lisa Beking and the team, welcome to Indonesia. Next, honorable lecturers and staffs of the Faculty of Fisheries and Marine Science, IPB University, honorable ladies and gentlemen, the participants of the lectures. First of all, I give praise and gratitude to God who has been giving us blessings and mercies so that we can gather in these lectures without any obstacles. Today is a great honor for me, Niken Octaviandini, to be standing here and welcome each and every one of you in this event. We proudly present the Ocean Voice X Embryo Talk series. Please give applause. Before we get to the main event, there will be an opening speech from the Dean of the Faculty of Fisheries and Marine Science. Ladies and gentlemen, we cordially invite Professor Dr. Ferdinand Yulianda to give a speech. Please take a step forward and the time is yours.
Okay, thank you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. And good morning, everyone. Yeah, first of all, I would like to welcome our guests from Wageningen University and team, Dr. Lisa Beking. And I forgot the name, Dr. Adriana Zade, you, yeah, okay. Maina Fokers, yeah. And Stephanie Martinez, where is? Another room, yeah, okay. And Francisco, yeah. As well as faculty member and workshop participant, who are attending both offline and online. Today, we will conduct the workshop of the Ocean Voice with the topic coral reef for today, which was initiated by Department of Marine Science and Technology, Faculty of Fisheries and Marine Science, IPB University, in collaboration with MVO, yeah. I can see MVO member here for you. You also, yeah. MVO is a scientific union in the faculty. In Indonesia, is one of archipelagic country that has a coral reef ecosystem on its islands, especially the small island. We have a lot of small island in Indonesia. It's surrounded by a coral reef. The area of this tropical ecosystem in Indonesia is estimated to be 2.5 million hectares, which are found spreading from Sangihe, the northern part of Indonesia, to Rote, the southern part of Indonesia, and also from Sabang in the west to Merauke in the east. Indonesian coral reef is very important to the world. Yeah. As long as Indonesia is located in the world coral reef triangle area, yeah. A total of 569 species and 83 genera of the coral, of hard coral. But coral is very important creature constructing the limestone skeleton in the sea. So that by forming a habitat for the various marine organisms. From 69%, if I'm not mistaken, and 76% of the genus of hard coral are found in Indonesia. In addition, in Indonesia is location of 4 endemic species of hard coral. Yeah. Namely, Afropora Suharsonoi in Lombok. Suharsonoi is the member of Dream. And the second, I don't remember that. The second is Epila valiensis in Bali. And the third is Edophilia makassarensis in Makassar. And the last species from Togian is Isopora togiensis. So we should protect this potential of rich coral reef resources. So that is existence coral continues. And biological diversity in the coral reef is not disturbed. So finally, the preservation of a coral reef is very meaningful benefit for human well-being. So today, so we will learn from the expert of coral reef. We'll talk about the how to monitor properly the coral reef. Enjoy the workshop. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Okay, thank you for the speech. Please give applause once again to Professor Dr. Ferdinand Julian. Next, there will be a forewords and research introductions, which will be delivered by the coordinator of the research team from Wageningen University and Research. I cordially invite Dr. Lisa Baking to give a speech. For Dr. Lisa, please take a step forward and the time is yours.
Oh, yes.
No, this is IPB meeting.
Okay.
For the first,
yeah. So, I'm sorry. Okay, you're on.
So I just use my friend. Yeah, maybe.
I just plug it. Yeah. Okay.
This one fast. This was easy. Thank you. This one?
Yep.
Okay. Good morning. Selamat masih pagi? No?
Yeah.
Masih pagi. This one? Okay, selamat pagi. So thank you very much. Thank you very much for welcoming us once again. And we are very happy to really get this project started together with IPB and many of our different colleagues. And we're very happy to be here. And I'm very happy to see a large group of students and faculty, as well as online. There seems to be all of Indonesia online. So this is very nice. Thank you very much for being here. We really, we really enjoy this. And so what I will do is give a brief introduction to the project of Marine Time Machine, which is a project that just got started and is funded by the Dutch Research Council, MAO, with part funding also from the Royal Academy of Sciences. And there are also PhD candidates within this who are funded by LPDP. And I am doing this work at Wageningen University, as well as Naturalis Biodiversity Center. Now, am I now in front of the camera? How does this work? Is this a problem?
Maybe.
Sorry.
Yep.
Oh, no. That's okay. You can. It was more. Thank you.
Yep.
Okay, I just wanted to start off with actually saying that this is a project that is currently started, but it's not, we've been working on these topics for a longer time with quite a large group of organizations from the academic side, as well as the private sector and the public sector and NGOs. And so it's both universities as well as research institutes. And to start with, as was given in the introduction, Indonesia, of course, is very rich biodiversity and very rich in coral reefs. And Indonesia still houses some of the most healthy and vibrant coral reefs. And if you go diving in Indonesia, and probably a lot of you already know this, you can see amazing coral reefs like this. So with very high coral cover. However, unfortunately, in this very near regions, you can also see coral reefs that look like this. So these are a very few live coral cover, there's sponges, algae, and a lot of this red slimy mats. They're called benthic cyanobacterial mats. And the thing with these mats, they're microbial mats with predominantly cyanobacteria, they're toxic, they cause anoxia, and they prevent corals as well as many other organisms to grow. So when they become very abundant together with algae, it's kind of bad news for corals. And so there's been quite a lot of coral reef decline. The main causes are in part due to global processes, such as climate change, as well as local stressors that are problematic for the reefs. And those are primarily overfishing and low water quality. And low water quality can be from various activities that we do on land, from agriculture runoff, deforestation, runoff of sediment, as well as building on the coast and untreated sewage systems. So the big question we have is, how is the coral reefs dealing with all of this change? How will the coral reefs transition under all this change? What will the reefs look like in the future? Yes. One more point that I want to bring is we tend to look a lot at climate change. There's quite a lot of research on that, and there's a lot of research about fishing and overfishing. It's kind of it's been a little bit more in the background about the low water quality, when that is a point that is an issue everywhere, but definitely also in Indonesia from various sources. And the point that we're looking at, that we're particularly interested in, is sedimentation from land, as well as nutrient enrichment. So nutrients coming from land, which ultimately cause eutrophication. And so that's an enrichment of nutrients within the sea, causing certain species to grow very fast. Now, the big question, when I was saying that what we're interested in, is what will happen to the reefs under all this change? Now we have some idea of how things will change based on their long-term data sets where people have looked at the same bits of reef over 40 years. And they've gone back every 2 years, made pictures of the reefs and analyzed them. And that was started by a coral reef biologist, Rolf Bach. He started it in the 70s, and then it was taken over by another coral reef biologist, Erik Meesters, who has also been to IPB a few years ago when we were invited by Havis Madupa. And so they've analyzed these pictures. We've been analyzing these pictures, and the way we analyze the pictures will later be explained by Francesco in his work. But based on this work, what we see is that the coral cover, so this is the years, these are this is the percentage cover, we see that the coral cover has gone down. And at the same time, the reefs have transitioned to a higher dominance of macroalgae. Now, for the long time, this was kind of where it was. And so that was around the 2000s, and there was an explosion of publications on this dynamic of coral, algae, and grazers. But in the past years, we've seen that the story is a little bit more complex, and we see other organisms, other groups coming up in the coral reefs. And so among others, cyanobacterial mats, you know, those slimy mats from the beginning, as well as sponges and soft corals. And so one thing we know for certain, unfortunately, is that the reefs of the future will function and look quite differently from these very high coral dominated systems. But we still don't really have a good grasp or a good understanding of what kind of bottom-up mechanisms, what kind of dynamics will cause the reefs to shift and in what way. And it is that which we are studying now with our marine time machine project. And is that really that are sort of the overall question in our project? And we aim to do that with marine time machines. And I will explain that briefly. So with marine time machines, we have quite a unique ecosystem at our disposal, which consists of three components. One are these systems that you see here. These are marine lakes. So they're small bodies of seawater surrounded by land. So you could see them as like inside out islands. And so they are saltwater, they have marine organisms, and yet they're connected to the sea through subterranean fissures and channels and these things. So we have these. And we don't have just one lake, we have many, many, many lakes. So throughout the years, together with a team, we've been documenting and finding these marine lakes. Particularly from the first years, it was Ludi, Aji, Vaban, Avaludi, Nuramat, Agustin, and Purvanto, and Dida, and Christian. We really have spent a lot of time looking and documenting these marine lakes. And now our team has grown and we have even more people that are also here that are joining us. And so from those lakes, we've selected 20 that are in a gradient of temperature. And so what our first component of the marine time machine are these marine lakes. We have the lakes represent this gradient in temperature, while most of the lakes have low water quality. And what I mean by that is that there's a high level of sedimentation, there's a high level of nutrient input. So they're what we call eutrophic. And then our second component of our time machine is that we look at reef sites where we take the natural variability, natural gradient in eutrophication. So our natural gradient in water quality levels due to human activities, so due to runoff, due to sewage, due to various activities, while the temperature and the reef sites are pretty much all the same, sort of now. And then our last component of the time machine is going back in time, where we do sediment cores, because these sediment cores give us a documentation of how diversity has changed over time and under what circumstances. And so we selected 20 lakes that are in a gradient of temperature. And if you go from one lake, and we've been working predominantly in, we have been working in Kalimantan Timur, but also in Papua, in Raja Ampat.
And where we're working now predominantly is in Aja Ampat, where we selected 20 lakes. And if you go from one lake to the next, you see an increase in temperature. So each lake kind of represents one temperature. And as you go from one lake to the next with increasing temperature, we see quite a decrease in diversity. And these lakes actually kind of represent natural laboratories or natural states of the temperatures that are being predicted for the future under kind of the worst case, the case climate change models. So these higher temperatures, so these would sort of represent the time of the temperatures in 2100. And what is more, let me just check, is what we see is that the groups that have become dominant in these higher temperature lakes are also the groups that we're starting to see emerge in the reefs. So these are the corals and these are more the cyanos and the sponges and the algae. So within our project, we are first of all sort of interested in how the communities transition under these different scenarios. And where we're just gonna say, we're just looking at quantifying the natural patterns. So we're saying, we're not doing experiments in here, but we're taking the natural experiment and understanding how the diversity has changed under these conditions. So where we're doing photo analyses, and later Stephanie Martinez will give an explanation of what kind of photo analysis we're doing, as well as working on the sediment cores and then looking in the past through sediment cores as well as genomics. And where we're really aiming to also develop methods that we can do genomics also more locally using the MinION. And this is work that is being, here we go. And so currently this is work that's being done by Stephanie Martinez, who's doing her PhD. Adriana Alzate, who's joined us, forces with us as a postdoc and has been funded by the Marie Curie European Fellowship, and Agustin Capriati, who is receives an LPDP. And subsequently, we're interested in how the interactions among these different groups change under the different conditions. So if you have conditions where certain groups are have disappeared, the question is how these groups, what the interaction is of these different groups under the different conditions when certain groups have disappeared. So what happens to the food web when you increase the temperature and you increase the nutrients? And so we're looking at food web analyses, at spatial interactions, as well as doing experiments to understand the energy transfer. And so this is work that is being done by Maina Folkers, who's here, who's doing her PhD within the project, as well as Ludi Aji, who received an LPDP to do his PhD in our group and is also working at BRIN. So based on that, I just want to say thanks. Thanks to the team. Thanks to you. And we're happy to have any questions before we start on the two workshops. And we will start later with the workshop by Francesco. And then we'll move on to the workshop by Stephanie. But for now, thank you. Yes, if there are no questions, we will just go straight. Or should I give it to the moderator?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, thank you for Dr. Lisa for the presentations. Is there any participants that wants to ask questions to Dr. Lisa? Okay, any others? All right, I think it's only one question. Oh.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning. Let me introduce myself. My name is Muhammad Wianto. I'm student of Marine Science and Technology, 58. And I have one question, Dr. Lisa. Yeah. from the research from your observe in coral reef ecosystem, is there a policy brief can help us, but as a student, researchers, or government of Indonesia itself, to more protect our coral reef ecosystem in marine ecological tropic from Indonesia itself? Maybe enough from me, and I hope I can attend to your Wageningen University in soon future. Thank you so much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Okay, thank you for the questions. You can read it.
Thank you for that question. And of course, you're more than welcome at that. Yes, wow, but it's a big question, right? I mean, having one policy brief. I mean, I think the answer lies in different components. So of course, there's a social component, there's a socioeconomic component. But if I look purely from the biology, let's say, from the ecosystem, what we do see is that if you can reduce the local stress, so the local problems like runoff, sewage, pollution, you do make the corals stronger, so that, or you at least don't make them weaker, so that they can deal more with larger problems. So if there's one thing that I would say that is something relatively local that you can do, is making certain that you don't give more stress to the corals. So sewage treatments, no coastal development, and preventing deforestation. But of course, the answer to all of those things are socioeconomic questions as well. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Lisa, for the introduction. So the next event is our main event. There are two lecturers that already here with us to explain some workshop for us. So there will be two training sessions. The first one is Coralnet Automatic Identifications of Phototransects, which will be delivered by Mr. Francisco. Okay, without wasting much time, Mr. Francisco, time is yours.
Thank you very much. While we're waiting, good morning, everyone. I do not speak Indonesian, and I have to be sincere, I forgot how to say good morning in Indonesian, so I'm very sorry about that. I'm here to give you a small presentation on Coralnet, which is a web portal used to identify coral species using phototransects. So I previously worked with this software for a project in the Caribbean, where with actually Eric Messners, which Lisa showed before, and this is a very useful tool which can be used to automate the species identification process during benthic surveys. But we're going to get more into it now. Hopefully.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. So I'm from Bakan University. I don't know if you can hear by my accent. I'm not Dutch. I'm Italian, and I'm currently studying there at a program that is rather similar to this faculty. Is a program of aquaculture and marine resource management. I work mainly within the marine resource management and fisheries group. And in my previous project, I worked on a monitoring project for coral reef health within the Caribbean, trying to understand how water quality correlates with coral cover around an island in the Caribbean called Saba, which within the Dutch Caribbean. And within this project, we tried to understand how decreasing water quality can have an effect on the coral cover of the coral reefs of the Caribbean. Unfortunately, the coral reefs within the Caribbean are very different from the one in Indonesia, which tends to be way more rich and way more vast. And so what we think might have happened is already, as Lisa showed in the past, decreasing water quality and climate change have had a very negative impact on the coral cover. Um,
Hola.
Okay, perfect. Okay, so okay, lovely. Does this work?
Yes.
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 Oh, it works. Oh, perfect. Lovely. Okay. So, as I was saying, I'm going to talk to you about Coralnet. It's a web solution for coral reef analysis. So it relies on the use of internet connection, and it's a open software. But we're going to get more into it now. So through this presentation, I'm going to give a brief overview of what Coralnet is, how it works, the training that needs to be done to use it. And I'm going to give at the end a brief practical demonstration on its different application. And then at the end, if you have any questions, feel free to ask them. So what is Coralnet? So simply put, Coralnet is a tool for surveys of benthic communities. I don't know how many of you have ever had any experience ever with this, but these are different pictures from different benthic communities surveys using photo transects. Now, benthic community surveys are a way to study ecosystems found on the seafloor or on the seabed. The way in which this is done is naturally in different forms. One of them can be diving and taking pictures. It can also be done using instruments or using boats of different kinds. The use that can be applied, as Lisa mentioned before, is to understand how benthic communities, and so communities found on the seafloor, are the characteristics of their habitat, the composition of these communities, and also we can use these studies to eventually assess the impact of marine development on benthic ecosystems. Now, this is naturally part of the framework that Dr. Lisa Becking mentioned beforehand. But to get more into depth, Coralnet relies mainly on the use of photo transects, so using either divers or underwater drones to take pictures. Now, Coralnet is an open source, open access web portal that can be used to facilitate the process of benthic surveys. The way in which this occurs is Coralnet allows you to more easily identify species found on the seafloor. This can go from corals to algae or sponges. Now, being an open source, it means that it's freely available for everyone. The only thing you need to do is register and then access the web portal. It's open access, so all the information within this website and within this tool is available without any unrestricted use. And there is a web portal. That means that it's a platform that gathers information from various parties. Now, Coralnet is used all over the world. And that means you have information on coral reefs that can be found in the Caribbean, within the Pacific, within the Atlantic, and within the Indian Ocean. Now, Coralnet was created by the University of California, and it is a freely available software that was optimized through the collaboration of many different institutions. Its utility is, as I said, for automated identification of benthic species. This means that if we provide a picture for a specific research, let's suppose very broadly, you're trying to find out which species are found within the Java Sea, you carry out a series of photo transects and you have pictures of the seafloor bed, such as this one, you need to identify the different species. Well, Coralnet helps you out by identifying the different species at different taxonomic levels. A very broad taxonomic level, it can tell you, well, this is a coral, but more in depth, it can even go in more in depth, identify the genus or the species of the coral, and we're going to see that afterwards. Now, how we can do it? Well, Coralnet requires you to provide it with a picture. And once you provide this picture, it uses a state-of-the-art machine learning process to provide an annotation. This annotation can be semi-automated. This means that it works both with the computer program and an expert that helps the computer program to identify the species, or fully automated. That means that the computer program is being trained enough to be capable of identifying the species itself. Now, the error rate of Coralnet right now is 18.4%. That means that out of 100 identifications, about 18.4 are wrong, but this must seem as a very high number. It is a rather successful number, and it's slowly decreasing as the interface becomes more advanced, as it analyzes more pictures. Now, in total right now, there are about 1.7 billion images on Coralnet, and these are obtained from about 2040 ecological surveys across the world. These are called sources within the web, and are different studies of different research groups all over the world. Coralnet is used by about 3,000 users, and these can go from government organizations, such as the NOAA Institute, which I don't know if you know about, universities, just Wageningen University, or simply research groups. Now, it allows for a collaboration of all these different organizations, which improves even further the web. So let's get more into it. How does Coralnet work? Well, Coralnet uses an image, and you need to provide this image, and tells you the species present in the image. For example, let's suppose we have this image. This actually comes from one of the surveys I did in the Caribbean. It can tell you that this is a hard coral, this is a soft coral, this is an algae, but it might not know what certain species are if you do not have a clear image. So for example, in this area, we were taking a picture, but there was not enough lighting, so Coralnet was not capable of identifying any species within a certain point. Now, to do so, Coralnet is provided with a label set. A label set is a sort of a legend that contains all the information of the different species that can be identified. For example, here you have Agaricia agaricius, which is a hard coral, and the label set provides a certain code to identify these species. And the more you train the coralnet with recognition of species, the easier it is for it to identify certain corals. But it does not only identify corals, it can also identify algae, substrate, invertebrates, or seagrass, or sponges. Now, let's just take some examples. Within my study, we are looking mainly at hard corals and other invertebrates. We had, for example, the Orbicella fabulata, and which looks like this. And so every single time we would find an image of an Orbicella fabulata, we would indicate to the to Coralnet that it would be this species by applying the code OFAV. In this way, the Coralnet will be able to learn the characteristics of the species by looking at different features, such as the large polyps it has and the strange shape of, let's just say, bumpy corals. Now, if we look at Polites asteroides, it's another form of coral, which is also bumpy, smaller polyps. So given the bright yellow color and the smaller polyps, Coralnet will learn the specific feature about this coral and we would identify by using the code PAST. And in this way, Coralnet would know that specific features of this coral would be assigned to the code PAST. But then if we found other species such as a boring sponge, which is this bright red invertebrate, we would identify it as being a boring sponge, and then the Coralnet will learn its characteristics and carry on. Naturally, there is a level of misunderstanding that can happen within Coralnet if the picture is not clear or if the corals look very much alike. But we're going to get more into it afterwards. Now, when you upload a picture on Coralnet and when you start to identify the different features of the picture, you need to provide Coralnet with metadata. Now, this metadata is all the information regarding the characteristics itself of the pictures, such as the date in which the picture was taken, the team that took it, the specific photographer, the depth at which it was taken, the island or the region in which it was taken, the latitude and longitude, the site and location and the characteristics, the camera used and the annotation status. Naturally, because all of this metadata gives the picture different characteristics. Using different cameras means that the picture that you provide has maybe different lighting, has different quality, and having a different photographer means that the capacity of taking pictures is different. Maybe one photographer pays more attention towards details, maybe one photographer pays more attention towards other features. And therefore, providing metadata helps out Coralnet to learn more about the picture and to improve based on who's taking the picture itself. Now, Coralnet needs to be trained to be able to recognize species and the various taxa. Now, to do that, Coralnet uses two parts. So it has a backbone network and a classifier training, and we're going to get more into depth with respect to this. Now, a backbone network is a large collection of all the data of all the research around the world. Now, this is general pictures taken by a lot of different people. This means that these pictures have different different qualities, they have different lighting, and actually are showing different ecosystem. Therefore, this backbone network is a very much generalized way of identifying pictures based on a broad range of data. Then you have a classifier training. Now, this is a specific for each source. By source, we mean a specific research or a specific site that has been studied for a long time. Therefore, the Coralnet knows that specific species can be found within a certain region. So if you take, for example, Indonesia, or in a specific region within Indonesia, Coralnet can be trained to identify corals based on the specific region, knowing which specific corals are found, how they look like, and the majority of cameras and pictures have been taken using Coralnet. Now, this classification is less detailed compared to the backbone network because it's limited the amount of pictures that you provide for each source. Yet it can be very useful because using the classifier training, Coralnet updates its backbone network, and so it proves itself throughout time. Now, I'm going to give you an example of two different pictures, one found within the backbone network and one found within the classifier training. So if you look at this image, it's a rather low quality image of a generalized C4 bottom that was found in, I think, California. Now, it is difficult for Coralnet to train based on this because it's a very general picture of very low quality. Yet you can also have the same picture that I showed you before, which has different amount of benthic groups, such as corals, soft corals, sponges, cyanobacteria, algae. And then this image from a specific source, in this case, Saba found within the Dutch Caribbeans, can be trained for the specific site. Therefore, Coralnet would use this picture to learn about more about the Dutch Caribbeans and the corals within the Dutch Caribbeans, and then classify the different corals within this region. Then take the information, bring it to the backbone network, and learn about corals in general all over the world. Coralnet needs at least 1,000 images to be initially trained in a site. Therefore, if you begin a new research in a site that has never been searched before, you need to provide it with 1,000 images. This means that you need to train it yourself, provide the image, and then identify the species within the image so that Coralnet can be trained. I'm going to show you now how that works. So the training process works with simply uploading the picture and the metadata within Coralnet. For example, let's take this picture. The software divides the picture in different sections. You can decide yourself how many sections you want to divide the picture in. The more sections you're going to divide the picture in, the more species you're going to identify within Coralnet. And in this case, we're just going to divide it in a 7x7 frame. As you can see, it contains 49 squares. And within each square, Coralnet plots a random point. Now, this is done so that when you identify a picture, there is no bias in the way in which you classify the benthos. And in this way, you make sure that there is no specific direction in which you want to go. For example, if you were to plot more points within this region, it will result that this picture contains a high percentage of corals. But in this case, we actually would have only one coral. So the random annotation allows you to have a more unbiased and overall correct view of how the benthos looks like, or the seafloor looks like. So we're plotting our dots. Now, once the plots have been, points have been dotted, the user can annotate every single point, confirming or overwriting suggestion from the computer. So the computer provides you with a certain suggestion. Let's suppose it identifies this as being a coral. You can confirm the coral or deny it, depending on whether the software is correct. Now, if you take another point, for example, this one, and the network identifies it as a coral, you can say, no, it's not a coral, it's actually a macroalgae, for example. And in this way, you improve the way in which Coralnet is capable of recognizing specific features. Then you can decide to add or remove labels from a data set. Now, as you saw before, we have a series of labels that we use to identify specific species. But let's suppose you find algae species that has not been recorded in the label set. You need to update your label set so that Coralnet knows to identify that specific species. So every single time you analyze a specific image, if you find something new, you can update the label set. And so Coralnet can also learn to identify some specific species that have not been known yet. On the software itself, it looks like this. It's a bit different, I know. So you have the uploaded image, you have the web interface, you have the label set, as you can see here at the bottom, which has different codes to identify different species. For example, we have here TUR, which stands for TUR algae, or we have ACROP, which stands for Acropora, the coral species. And then you have your settings. These settings allow you to zoom in or zoom out of the image to see maybe more details or to increase the brightness or the contrast to improve the visibility of the image. And then you have your random point notation. Now you can see you have different points here around the picture. These are random points I was talking about. In this case, there are about 30 random points. So there is a lower amount of grid that was done before, but you can assign yourself, as I mentioned before, how to identify different species. And then here you have the predictions by Coralnet. Now, if you look, for example, at the point in which we are now, 9 in green, now Coralnet says that this is SAM, which is correct. And you can see there is a percentage next to the code itself. It says 96% chance that this is SAM, 2% chance this is a poritus, or 1% there is a crystalline coralline algae. Now, naturally, the 96% is the correct option. So you, as a trainer, can click on scent, and in this way, Coralnet recognizes that this is scent and learns the feature of the specific point is looking at. Now we can look at different also points here. For example, 5 and 3 have already been classified as poritus. In this way, Coralnet learns also to recognize specific corals, substrate like sand or algae. Now, the accuracy of prediction changed within time. The first Coralnet version, the beta, had a 71% recognition capacity. So 71% of the identifications were correct. The updated version increased to 77.5%, which is pretty good, looking at actually a human has an 80% accuracy rate. This depends on the expertise of the human naturally and this capacity of recognizing certain species and experience it as. Now, every night, Coralnet, as I said before, takes the daily identification and updates its precision. And in this way, it continuously improves every day. Now, we can go through a small practical demonstration. I can show you now how actually Coralnet works. Great. So thank you so much. Thanks. So as you can see, this is the first interface that you have when you open Coralnet is the welcoming page. Oops. As you can see here, we have a map which shows all the different sources that are being analyzed all over the world. You have a different amount of research happening in different areas. And therefore, when you see, for example, different colors, like you have the purple color, 170, 168, that means it's 170 sources that are analyzing corals within the area. So for example, the Great Coral Reef of Australia has been very much researched using Coralnet, while areas such as Indonesia, unfortunately, have 19. So it means there is still a lot of research that can be done using Coralnet. Now, I have a source here, which is the coral reef monitoring within Bonaire. And we can click on it and access our source. Now, this source per se has a lot of different images from a lot of different resources. So if you click on images, we can access all of the images of the data set. While if you click on metadata, we can access all the metadata of the different source. And the label set, we can actually access the label set of our source and look at it. Now, the label set and the metadata can only be changed by whoever created the source, and so is the owner of the source itself, while the researchers that have been invited to collaborate can upload images and identify them. Now, you can browse different images. As I said here, you can see all the metadata that we have from the beginning. And in this case, we're going to analyze pictures from Sabah done by a specific photographer, Franier. We are going to look at a specific site, which is site S3, which is here at the bottom. Yeah, here. And so we click on the search button, and it should open up all the pictures that I identify with the specific metadata. Oh, la, la. Okay, so here, for example. Now, I'm not going to open this up. I was just wanted to show you a specific example where the bentos that we identified was only sent, right? So you can see this specific source has 96 pictures. This is for the first 20 ones. And these 96 pictures are only sent. I can tell you that because I analyzed them, which is rather boring because you have to keep clicking send. But when we identify this specific source, we taught Coralnet how to recognize Caribbean scent simply. While if we look at another site, such as S4 here, we have a site that is much more richer in corals. Now, if it loads, hopefully, we can see it. Yeah. So as you can see, this is completely different. Now, if we were to open up any image, wait, let's open a better one. Oh, this is something else that is also very important. Whenever you upload an image from Coralnet, you have been taking a picture underwater. That means that the color but of the picture that you have is has a sort of a blue filter because of the light of different lighting. So before uploading a picture on Coralnet, you have to adjust the lighting for the specific situation. So if we were to upload, let's open this one. So this is our image. Now, when you open an image, this has already been annotated, but this is just an example. When you open the image, you can click on the image details to see the different metadata, or you can click on the annotation tool to annotate the specific image. Now, if you click on annotation tool, as you can see, the image opens up with 49 randomly assigned points. Now, this specific picture was already analyzed, so it's going to be difficult to show the different identifications that we have done. But if we, for example, want to zoom in on a specific point, like one, for example, as you can see, we can zoom in. Now, this was simply identified as a sponge because we were not very interested in researching the genus of sponges. We just wanted to see the general presence of them. Our main focus was on corals. So the main identification that occurred was on corals. But let's suppose we delete this classification. We can, let's do this. This is not working, I don't know why. Yeah, so if I see this and I see it's a sponge, I can write the code sponge. As you can see, as I type S, the different labels that are assigned to our specific label set pop up. So I could, for example, identify it as set, which would be wrong. So I am going to identify it as sponge, and I'm going to pass on to the next point. So this, for example, was identified previously as turf algae, but we couldn't just simply for example's sake, delete it and identify it as turf algae. Now, if we were to reset the whole set, we're resetting it. Okay, this is not working. Mm. I don't know why it's not resetting, but if we were to reset it, all these different label set would disappear, and then we would have to identify from the beginning again. Now, something you can do if your whole image is of a specific kind, you can simply, like, let's suppose this image was all sand. You can simply press on this. You can simply press on this, and it's not going to work because we've already identified, but you can press on this button and you can just type in sand and identifies all the points as being sent. Once you identify an image, you can press on saved, which in this case is not available because it was already all saved. And yeah, you can move on to the next image, which should be loading. I apologize for not being able to identify anything, but within the source that I'm working with, everything is already been identified. So I'm going to have to go to a different source. Let's try this. So. Okay, perfect. So if we take again the same island, for example, Saba, and we can show the annotation status of our image, which can be either confirmed, unconfirmed, or unclassified. So we show unconfirmed, so is any image who has not been searched yet. So if we click on search, it should search for all the images of Saba that have not been identified yet. So depending on the different islands that you use, yeah, you can have different images. So for example, yeah, here we have some images from another researcher that is currently doing his research in Saba. We can click on annotation tool and annotate this image for them. Now, if you go down towards the bottom, you can look at the team that took the picture. In this case, is Yang, the site in which it took seven and the depth at which it took this picture, 60 meters. Now, I'm not going to identify it itself because this is his picture and I'm not going to work on his work. But just for example's sake, if you click on the first one, it shows you in this first point, which we can zoom in. Now, after it was trained by all the pictures that we have uploaded, it tells you it's a 43% of this being turp, 41% of being discussed, which is a short label for we need to discuss this point with somebody else because we are not uncertain. It's a 7% chance of being a turbinated algae, a 2% chance of being a sand, or 1% chance of being dictyota. Point, which as you can see is very red, is an 88% chance of being cyanobacteria, 3% chance of being turf algae, 1% being unknown, 1% being dictyota, and 1% being sand. And you can carry on for all the 49 points that are present in this picture. Now, if we were to take a more interesting point, like here, 29. Yeah, so 22. So if we zoom in 22, for example, this is a rather difficult picture to identify because it's low quality, but what could be happening is that this is a specific kind of coral. But as you can see, the coralnet pointed right next to the coral. So it's recognizing this 22 as being sand with a 26% chance, or turf algae with a 22% chance. Now, because the picture itself is low quality, it is difficult for coralnet to recognize what it is. Higher quality pictures are allowed you to have a much higher chance of understanding. This one, right? Yes. Okay. Perfect. So sorry. Thanks. So this is a brief overview of how Coralnet works, like all the different features they have. So if you have, it's fine. It's just one slide. It's fine. You can just do this. Well, if you have any picture, any questions, you can feel free to ask. And thank you for your attention. Okay. Yes.
Okay, maybe three questions. Okay, who's going to be the first one who want to ask? Please move forward to, okay.
First of all, I thank you for the opportunity. For the opportunity that is given to me to ask these questions. And I would also like to introduce myself. My name is Ananda Wikrama. I am a student of the Marine Science and Technology Department of IPB University, Batch 58. I would like to ask a question regarding the workshop provided by Mr. Francesco. So number one, I would like to ask, is Coralnet, as of right now, as productive and efficient in comparison to identifying using an identification book, and or has already become a much more efficient alternative to manual identification? Thank you.
Thanks for the question. It is a tool that is being trained right now. It was created in 2021, so it's only 2020, so it's 3 years old. But right now it is as efficient as using an identification book. So the hope it is that as we go on with the automated annotation, Coralnet becomes so efficient, it is capable of recognizing the pictures itself. So all it would take for a researcher is to upload the pictures. Coralnet will recognize them automatically. There's a possibility of double checking the annotation of Coralnet naturally, but then to just have, for example, 1,000 pictures being analyzed in about an hour. And that would save a lot of time and work for the researcher.
Thank you very much, Mr. Francesco.
Yeah, thank you for the question.
Another one?
Okay, thank you for the opportunity. I guess I'm going to introduce myself. My name is Daniel. I am another student of Marine Science and Technology Department. I guess my question is a bit simple. I just wanted to know when or what specific action triggers to train a new classifier, and how long does the Coralnet take to train a possibly a new classifier?
Yeah, so the opening of a new classifier, a new source, is usually done with a new research project. So let's suppose a new research project is opened up within Indonesia, in a specific region of Indonesia. What you can do is that you can apply to become the handler of a source, and then Coralnet gives you all the credentials to enter. You can open your own source and start to upload your pictures. And after 1,000 pictures, that source, the Coralnet is capable of starting to identify by itself. Naturally, 1,000 pictures is still an initial number that you need to upload with, and then you can still help out Coralnet to identify, but it starts to speed up the process the more pictures you upload and the more precise it gets as you upload more pictures.
Thank you Francis, for
presentation. My name is
Can you hear me, right?
Yep. Yeah, I hear you.
Hello, my name is Asri. I'm from another project with Dr. Lisa Becky from INRIF. I really interested with the software, the Coralnet, because I'm going to identify as well the benthic, but I never done the this application. So I was wondering, like you mentioned 1,000 pictures for metadata.
Yep.
Is it one place or like
multiple places
in a country? Okay, and then can we the researcher can access the other researchers metadata within one country or
So to access the metadata of a researcher depends on which kind of project they have. You might have to ask permission or not, just to say hello, can I have a view of your metadata and the different characteristics that it has. Now, to start to identify corals yourself, if within a region you have multiple sites, it's very useful for the Coralnet to be to start to understand the benthic composition of the specific source, of specific region, and this way it gets trained better. Naturally, in theory, it is possible to use pictures from the Caribbean to train it in Indonesia, but it is better to use Indonesian corals to train it for an Indonesian source because it becomes more precise in the way in which it's identifying. That 1,000 initial pictures usually, in my experience, always come from a researcher themselves and their project. So you have to start with your 1,000 pictures initially, and you have to annotate them yourself one at a time, which is a very, I can tell you, is a very time-costing process. But you can ask help from other people. And the nice part about Coralnet is its open access characteristics, the fact that it can be accessed by anyone. And within the scientific community, Coralnet is really a helpful tool because it allows researchers to also connect very easily. And so let's suppose you would need some help from somebody who already used it in Indonesia. You can find the project, and if it's an open access project, you can also look at their picture and the metadata. If it's a closed access process project, you can ask to have access to the metadata, and you can just explain the project that you're working on. And I can pretty much guarantee that usually other researchers are very helpful within Coralnet and give you access to the resource.
About the angle, how many angle of the picture, and what the last question is, what is the limitation of this software?
Yeah, so the angle ideally is just to have parallel to the seafloor, because so just literally 180 degrees, because you really all the software has been trained this way. So about 1 meter, 1.5 meters above the seafloor, that's the deal. Some people use a wide angle, like I did, but that kind of ends up with the edges of the picture being a bit squished compared to the rest. Some people use just a normal angle, or wide angle, or a fisheye, depending on your angle. The ideal situation is to be parallel to the seafloor. I think the main limitation with Coralnet is the training that is done by people. So if somebody that does not have a lot of knowledge trains it and trains it wrong, Coralnet starts to fail naturally. So if I have a person that has very little capacity of recognizing algae and might identify a turbina as a dictyota, then Coralnet learns from that mistake to make mistakes. And so it will start to identify wrongly things and might be misleading. It happened to me that some people that were using it on my project identified a lot of algae wrongly, and I saw that and I fixed it. But then I would say this is the main limitation. You naturally have to be careful, and you need to be knowledgeable of what you're dealing with, which is why also having books, having knowledge of the corals, checking the corals can be very useful. And then naturally, the fact that you're looking at a picture that have been taken in the past, maybe also by somebody else, is a bit limiting, because you end up maybe with a picture that doesn't have a very high quality, and then it's very difficult to identify a coral. And at that point, while with a normal transect and with a person in the water taking notes of the number of corals, you're there, you're present within the sea, so you can look at the characteristic of the coral, you can take more time to analyze it. If you have a picture, it's that snapshot, and you just rely on that, and that's it. So I would say these are the two main limitations of Coralnet.
Thank you. Maybe any other questions from the participants? Okay. Please come forward.
Morning, thank you for the opportunity. My name is Rapidas Girtan. I'm from Maritime Science Technology. So my question is, from what I learned from your presentation, Mr. Francisco, is that we can have our own source on Coralnet, and then we can train it specifically, like it's very person or project specific for the annotations. But how does it help to the backbone network? And is there any general like annotations that can help me if I'm new to this web? Maybe that's my questions. And one more thing, how does we have to set our pictures, like any processing or like that before?
Yeah, thanks. Thanks for the question. So naturally, Coralnet has a basic label set that you can use to decide your labels and have specific training that is done based on the backbone network. The backbone network uses each source to update itself. So it's like a central body, like a literal backbone, that then uses what has been identified in a specific source and updates itself every night. And this improves the capacity of the engine to recognize pictures for each source. Naturally, the most important part is the training you give to your specific research and your specific source, because Coralnet really relies on that for its own learning. When it comes to the image modification, that is a big issue, mainly because depending on how you modify your picture, your identification may be different. So let's suppose a coral is very yellow and Coralnet recognizes it because it's yellow. If you have a picture with a very strong blue filter and you don't change it, maybe the color doesn't appear to be so yellow and so it misidentifies it. So it's very important to have a certain amount of settings that you should know, you should learn about regarding how to modify the picture. I have a specific software that does it for free. I think it's called XNAMP, I think. I'm not too certain, it's not on my head. But what you just simply have to do is change the filter that the light gives within the water, but that is another straightforward process. It's not very difficult, it's very known, and unless you really insert some crazy values and then everything becomes very red, it doesn't work. But usually it is a rather intuitive process. The important part is modify those pictures so that they do not have the filtering of the blue light. Thank you very much for your question.
Okay, maybe any other participants want to ask questions, or is it enough? Okay, maybe it's enough. Thank you, Mr. Francisco, for answering the questions and delivering the materials today. I think we can go to the next event. Please give applause to Mr. Francisco.
Thank you, Corinne.
Okay, so next we will move to the second session of the trainings, which is 3D photogrammetry training for coral reef monitoring by Ms. Stephanie Martinez.
Another person.
You
also just transferred the material that I also needed for the program.
Oh, okay.
But I also have the presentation.
Oh, yeah. What? Oh, this is.
Yeah.
Yep.
So good morning. I'm Stephanie Martinez, and I'm a PhD candidate for working with Lisa Beckin for the Marine Time Machine Project. And mostly been working in the difference of abundance and cover composition of reefs, and during my career also in different methods, so with pictures, also models. And, today I want to show you a little bit how can you make 3D models out of an object in the reef. You go from planar projections in a 2D picture to a 3D model.
The next is,
So first I want to explain a little bit of what is photogrammetry, which is the technique which is based to build 3D models. How do you collect your data? Then how can you generate 3D models with the axis of MetaShape, which is a software? And then maybe do a little bit of a practical demonstration of with the software, how and what is the workflow? So what is photogrammetry? So found it interesting when I was making this presentation, like to really look for the technical definition, and it starts with, oh, it's an art, science, and technology.
Sorry.
Yeah, it's okay. Okay. So photogrammetry. There we go. So yeah, it's defined as an art, science, and technology, and it's actually as old as photography itself. And it's because it's just based on getting information out of images and see if you can measure and interpret these images. And it's then you have also used it yourself without maybe knowing it. For example, when you take a panorama picture with your phone. So the principle of how photogrammetry works is with triangulation. And one of the, for example, examples is like when they do aerial shots and you have images, and then what you have to, you find different points in common within these images to assess and then measure. So yeah, you gather this data about an object by analyzing the change in the position within these images. So types of photogrammetry, you have aerial photogrammetry, which has been used to create maps, plans, and models. So what you have in Google Maps, for example. You also have field photogrammetry, which is for more complex subjects. So it's used a lot in architecture and in situ projects. So in this archaeological sites, for example, when they also make these videos and pictures and they can reconstruct it. But yeah, like in our group, what we wanna do and use is to apply it on the reefs, which technically you can see it as a merge of these two, because the reef is like what you have down there, but you also have very complex individuals and structures within. So it's kind of like a mix between both. So traditional surveys in reefs, as Francesco was explaining before, you usually lay out a transect, and you have your defined area and you take a picture from the top. So this is has been very useful in the past decades, and it still is, but it does ignore, or it doesn't take into account that it is very 3D and complex system. So, so like when you have massive and erect organisms, you're underestimating like the cover of these organisms within your study. So what is really like a lot of labs are trying to do now is like to maybe incorporate this 3D component into the service. And it's really nice because you can estimate the volume of organisms in non-invasive ways. So this is for my master project that was, for example, measuring the volume of sponges and then also doing the 3D model to see how accurate these models could be, and typically how you will measure also the volume of the sponges, you need to take out the organism and like put it in the water bucket and see how the volume changes. So this is like a way to actually not to destroy or to kill the organisms and still get the information that you want. Another more complex applications that are being developed is fine scale mapping. So this is, I think this is about, well, it's a very long transect, but in this study, like they take very detailed pictures and videos of a reef, and you can do, first of all, very detailed maps. And then if you have the reference of the individuals that are interested in, for example, you wanna do genomics of a certain species, you can always pinpoint them in your map and then relate it to your genetic data, for example. But that's not only that, like you have a very nice map, but you can do multi-species assessment with polygons and see, yeah, what is your benthic community, having that suitability. So you can do all this classification based on the images that you produce. Also track, for example, growth in your colonies. So it opens up a lot of possibilities. And in this study, for example, they made a 3D model, but then you can also obtain your planar image, but it's a bit more accurate in a sense. So that's what you get, like it also looks like. So a little bit of how can you collect the data? What do you need? Well, you need fairly good cameras. So that can go from a newer generation GoPros to maybe an Olympus TG 5 or 6, the newest, or a reflex camera. And the decision on which one to use really depends on what do you want to extract from your model. So, and also it's a matter of cost balance, because of course reflex cameras are very expensive. So then you really have to see, okay, what do I want to get out of my models? And with this type of camera, you will get a better, higher quality texture. So it's like the definition of your picture is going to be more accurate. And with the other ones, it might be less, but then again, they are faster in the use and a bit cheaper. So you really have to assess which one to choose there. Then you really need very good scale bars, because this is how you increase the accuracy and how you can compare something that's virtual into what is the reality. And it's important to consider the size of your object. For example, if I want to model this control here, if you have a scale bar that is this size, you know, it is good enough because the proportion of the scale bar and the object is okay. But if you want to model this room, like you cannot use the scale bar that is this size because your accuracy is going to decrease. So you have to think about that. You need a color card for correction. This is only, they also do this even if it's not underwater. But underwater is even more important because how the colors vary and like the absorbance of light underwater. And you also need depth and orientation control points. Explain that better here. So this is a bit of an overview of how you would maybe set up your area. So first you have the permanent marker. In this case, they put like a stick upright. I usually use another type of markers, but this is an option. You, for example, have this points in the quadrant, which can also be used as permanent markers. Then you need your ground control points, which are, they put it as a square here, but it can be any object that you know the scale. So this is, you need several of this. So also you can, in a way, train the model when it's building it. Because as if you have more control points, then your model will also be more accurate. Well, the fourth, this is the survey area. And this is what is also you can add is a spirit level with a water pass. So it's like this construction. It's like a ruler that has like this bubble inside.
Yeah, you know it.
Yeah, okay. So with this, you can, you need to set it up straight. So when you are orienting your model, it knows which way is up. So that's why you can do it. You can do it, of course, visually, but this is like more repeatable in time. So you can do different things. You can either take pictures or you can take a video. Again, depends on the size of your area, what do you want to obtain from it. But if you want to do, for example, just one colony, like what I was doing with my sponges before, what makes most sense is like to swim around it with your camera. And because it's easier and you really get all the points. Now, if you're doing more like a quadrant or a bigger area, like whole transect, it's just, you can just swim in a pattern like zigzag, but always making sure you are overlapping your images. I think I haven't explained that, but the key thing is that your images overlap, because as I said before, with triangulation, that's how the program is going to find the common points. So generating 3D models with Ahisoft Metashape. This is a widely known program, and I think a lot of the latest publications use this because it's fairly easy to use and it has many, many capabilities. There are three types of licenses. So the standard, which is free, but it has limited functions, but it's still, you can make your models. So that's, I think, important. You have the professional, which then you can add and measure other metrics within the model and maybe refine some details. And the educational, which is actually a professional, but with a very nice discount when you purchase it. Good thing about this program is that there's no limit in the number of images you can add. And I think other software do have this. So I think that is why it's worth it. And well, bit of a limitation is always the computer power you need for the models. Again, I want to repeat that it really depends on what you want to do. If you have small models or small organisms that you're targeting, you don't need like a NASA computer, let's say that. But if you want to do maybe really long transects or very more complex stuff, then I would say that this would be a bit of a minimum that you need in hardware. And the most important thing really is to have a graphical part, because that's how the program works much, much faster. A bit of an overview of how the interface works. It's quite friendly. So you have here, these are your chunks. So this is where you upload and put all your images. Then you have a menu with all the tools. And then here you can see like your cameras or images. And then in the middle, you can see your model. So you usually start by aligning these photos, which means it's gonna find the common points within the images. That's what it means. Then you're gonna, it builds like this sparse point cloud, which is all these common points that it found. So that's the point cloud. Then the dense point cloud is where it does more like the connection between the points. And then you have a mesh, which is like the texture. So it's what it makes it look pretty. Like here, and so you can see like these are more like three-dimensional views. And then also a nice thing about Ahisoft is that you can get the orthographic view, which is the perpendicular view. And I did this before for my bachelor, and I took pictures, and then I had with another software align them myself, and then it was very messy, so a lot of work. And the nice thing is that if you do it with this program, you have your 3D model, and then you can get this view already with a click of a button, because it does almost everything. And then these are more like the products or what you can measure. So here, for example, you can have the surface and the volume of your object. You can have the closing shapes, and you can get really into all these metrics and depends on what you need. So I can maybe do a little bit of a practical demonstration. I have a very small set of images that I can show you and then make a bit of a model, show you how the program works. Okay.
Yeah.
So you see the program. Yeah. So I have a set here. It's very small and it's just a small colony, so very complex. But you can see. Yeah. You can see that there's a small color colony there. And then these were images that were taken sequentially going around, right? So if you take a video, you can always split the video into frame rates, right? And then you obtain images from your video. And yeah, I would recommend having a higher frame rate so you can, with the blur and blurring and such, you can really pick up the best pictures. So now going into the details. So this is the program, right? And the nice thing, and why I think it's very friendly as well, is because when you go to workflow, all the steps are there in order. So that's very easy. So you can add photos, you can add a folder, which I'm gonna do. This folder called Colony. See, and it uploads all my pictures. So you can have them down here. And it uploads them into a chunk. So you can have actually a project with different chunks, and you upload into each chunk a bit of your model, let's say. So if you have maybe a very big transect and you wanna somehow segmentize it, then maybe you can add chunks to each part one way. Then once you have your photos, you could, if you want, you can always do camera calibration. In theory, the program does it automatically. It detects which cameras took the picture and does the calibration for it. So if it was a GoPro, Canon, or it should be able to recognize it with the metadata of the picture. You can calibrate the colors. You can use the source data. You can calibrate it with white balance. It's very flexible. So now we say aligned photos. And now usually I leave this as it is. And depending on your computer power here, you can put it, for example, with medium or low or lowest. So you can always try how that goes. So let's put it on high for now. And then okay. And then it will detect all the overlapping points between the images. This one should be fairly easy because it's a small part. Takes a little bit, but it's very nice to see the process, I think. Okay, so it looks very ugly now, but don't be scared. So this is the point cloud. So it's really sparse, right? So it just found all the common points within all the images we took. And you can see that there's some points that are kind of off, but that also comes from when you're taking the image, if there's like objects, especially in the borders, it's when it becomes a little bit fuzzy. So when you're filming your object, you should really make sure you have enough border for this error. And yeah, it does this because there's maybe objects that are confusing, like the points in the edges. So that's why sometimes you can have this random scare and point clouds there. Or for example, if you're in a reef and you're filming around and then you see open, like the open blue, then that also can, you know, mess with it because suddenly you have a big blue patch in the side of the model. But that's okay so far. What you can also do at this point, for example, you say, oh, I know this is not gonna work out. You can always select it and delete it. So you have all those points discarded. So for your next part, your model will be more, it will be cleaner. So then the next one we align, then we can build a mesh. Again, I usually leave this as it is because it's good enough for what I want. And then again, you will start making the mesh. So this is the connection between these points that we found. All right, so we have now a mesh. It still is, you wouldn't say, oh, this is very pretty, right? However, it is your mesh and you can actually measure your textures, like your the shape and your surface from it. So you can see what I said before, that the edge is always a little bit fuzzy. And okay, so another important thing is that you have this circle, and then with this circle you can always move around the model and play with it, right? It's a bit annoying sometimes, but you get the hang of it, and you do need a mouse to use it. So okay, we did this. So now the next thing is to build the texture. So I run it, let it run. And yeah, I guess an important feature is that you can do batch processing. So if you have similar footage, different models, you can always do a batch processing. But you say, yeah, I have all these folders, I want you to do the alignment and all these processes by step. And then you just keep that running overnight. It's not like you have to do this and wait every time. So you can tell the program, do all of these folders, do all of that, and then you come back later to it. So now it does look nicer. And you can see the edges is always a problem again, but our coral colony is very, very detailed. So you can play with it. You can zoom in, zoom out. With this tool here, again, you can always build, make your, let's say, clean it and make it like I only want this coral. Yeah. So you see that because it's a 3D space that there's a little bit, this little chunk stay there. So you always have to move it around to see which parts you can actually delete. I had it sometimes that I think I'm doing a straight line and then I move it and I deleted half a chunk of the model. So you always have to be checking that. And you have different, you can see the shades. You can have your solid model. So this is where you can see more like the surface and the volume of the model. You can see the wireframe. This is very cool. This is literally all the connections between all those points it found. The confidence of your model. Oh, I deleted the other chunks, I think. Here we go. You can see that the confidence in the middle is 100%, that is correctly built, and the edge effect is always kind of fuzzy. And there we have the texture again. You can also check for the cameras. I also think this is a cool setting where you can see the angle of which your camera was pointing and each of these images was pointing. And you can always see like, oh, this picture was way off, for yourself to also see, you know, this pattern work, maybe, you know, I'm missing information on this side, so I can go and reconsider if you have a chance to go and do it again. Another thing, I think for me, that would be like the basics of what you can do. You can then export this, right? You save it, you can save your project. You can export it as a point cloud. I have never used that. But you can also export your model, which is a OBG file, but you have many other types of files that you could export it to. And you can actually import this OBG file into GIS software. you can then georeference your model, especially if you're doing very long transects. You can then assign, this is point A, this is point B, you put it on a map. You can also, within your control points, if you have, for example, the depths, so you know that this is, I don't know, 5.5 meters, this is 10 meters, like in a very big chunk, then you can also put that in your GIS files and then increase that accuracy of the model. And you can, yeah, you can also export it as an image, like for the orthographic view. So I hope that gives you a little bit of a sense of what you need to make a 3D model. And of course, there's many other extra technical details that I'm happy to answer if you have questions.
Okay, maybe any participants wants to ask questions?
Excuse me. Do you think that I'm from Zoom can also ask questions?
Yeah, of course.
Yes.
Okay.
If anyone from the Zoom meetings wants to ask questions, you can use the features, the raise hand features, I mean.
Oh, okay. Okay. Hang on. Sorry. Yes. Okay, thank you so very much for the opportunity to also participate in this training session. It is very useful tool, actually, and I'm very interested to be able to try it, if only this can be shared freely with us here in Malang, in Brawijaya University. My name is Umi Zakia. I'm a lecturer from Faculty of Fisheries and Marine Science, Brawijaya University. And also some of my students' research is about coral reef as well. Actually, we have also area in the eastern part of East Java, in Banyuwangi. If you may already know the city, we also have a kind area of coral reef there in Bali Strait, but nearby the Banyuwangi coastal area. I was wondering whether the file, I mean the file, we can choose the area of coral reef around the world, or only just for specific in Europe or something like that. My questions about the files of the coral reef you use for in this example, mm-hmm. is it can be applicable for other area in Indonesia?
Probably. Yeah, so this technique you can use for anything that you wanna measure from images and build into a 3D space. So I mean, I use a tiny coral colony from the Caribbean, but you can use any object or any reef from any area that you would like. It's just important to have the considerations of when you set up your area, how are you gonna film it or take the pictures. But in essence, it can be in any place and any place and any object that you would like to bring from the real world into the computer.
Oh, I see. Yep. So this image is not based from satellite images?
No, these were pictures I took from the diving.
So, I see.
The camera, I just took diving there, yeah.
Yeah, sorry for my misunderstanding, of course.
No, I
thought it was, we can also see it from any satellite images, or we can process it from any, yeah. We use the SAMS satellite images to process for coral reef. Yeah, but I don't know. I mean, yeah, of course, it depends on the tools. Yeah. So it means that we have to have the real picture first, and then you can put it, the files into these tools.
So you have, if you have an area that you can geolocate, then you can make the model and then upload it to your GIS file, program. And if you have remote sensing data, you can always overlap this data, right? Because it's, if it's geo-referenced, then you can always try to find the match.
Oh, okay. Is there any specific requirement for the extensions of the file? I mean, as images in JPEG or maybe any other, or PNG, or?
You can, in the program, you can put any image you want, any format. It's always, but we choose between raw images or JPEG images, usually.
Ah, I see. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Thank you so very much for your information. Hope that we can also use the tools. Is it, I mean, was it license or?
Yeah, you have different type of licenses. So there's a free one, and then you have the professional license that costs a bit more money. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Sam, so much.
Okay, maybe we can move to the next participant.
Okay, thank you for the opportunity. I would like to introduce myself first. My name is Hasna Rupa. I'm from Marine Science and Technology Department. So the question is, since it has camera calibration, can you use it if the picture was taken from different type of cameras? And can we kind of analyze it if the size of the images is different? Thank you.
So you're asking if we can use two type of cameras, but yeah, you could actually, because it will calibrate for each type of camera that you put. So you could potentially have a chunk for one camera and another chunk for the second camera. Then you can, in that sense, have a better control of what's calibrating. And yeah, the size image doesn't really matter as long as you have the overlap. So you need to have a bit of 2/3 of overlap between your images. But yeah, if one image is, I don't know, a rectangle ratio and the other one is a square, it's not gonna matter.
Thank you for the answer.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Yep.
I'm Lisa, faculty member of this faculty of fisheries and marine science. So I think your technique is quite the same with what we are doing, and our technique to process the image from drone. But my question is, is there any rules to build the 3D things like this underwater? You mentioned before that you took the picture around the object. But is there any rules that how far we took the photo or take the photo or
from the object?
Yeah, from the object, or something like that. Or or we have to build something like tools that so the height of the photo taken is quite the same with other picture that we take.
Yeah, so underwater drones, I guess. So depends on the quality of the sensor and the camera, because if it's high enough, I think 1.5 meters either from the bottom is fine. And it also depends. I don't think you need to calibrate or make it, because if you just go closer to the object, that you're just gonna have more detail of that point. So if for any chance you just go closer, you know, and you go back, it's really not gonna make a bit of a difference. You're just gonna have a better representation of that spot because you got more detailed information. So if you try to maintain a 1.5-2 meter distance from your floor, the benthic floor, that's okay. But I don't know if you're like doing surveys that are kilometers, which these other sensors, and that's, I think, a little bit different.
Because my background is from remote sensing and GIS, I need to know how high, because it's related to the spatial resolution that affect the accuracy, of course.
Yeah.
If you want to identify the object.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, are you doing like a reef, or is it what kind of?
If I use drone, I can use the method of object-based image analysis.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So from the above sky, we can predict what is the substrate along the shoreline. This type of method, I think it's quite the same what we are doing in our field.
Yeah.
So it's nice, and I think it's for
Francesco,
can we mix the method that she used with Coralnet, because it's I think it's reliable for that to make more accurate for the object, for the species. Is there any possibility for doing that?
Not that I know of, because all the pictures I worked with were 2D, but it might be. I think it has to deal, Coralnet still has to develop to that level, because for now AI images recognition works mainly on a 2D space, and being a 3D space probably would also bring a lot of different features. So for now, I'm pretty certain it's not happening, but I can tell you that I can imagine somebody already thinking about this in somewhere in California and saying, oh, it's next step. So it might be happening. For now, Coralnet, it's mainly working on 2D images. I think the main issue with 3D images is going to be a lot of data that is going to be input within Coralnet. So while a 2D image is just that image, a 3D image has so much data within it, and it's rather heavy, I think. Stephanie, confirm with you, I'm right or not, but it's going to take more time for sure to develop something like that.
Asking this for developing software, I think.
Yeah, it might be. Who knows? Maybe in Indonesia is going to be the first attempt.
Thank you very much.
So you could, from the model, take the orthographic view and then cut that into 2D images that you can then put into Coralnet.
I think we can do it orthomosaic, right? With
Akisos? Exactly. So
with your data, we can build orthomosaic after build mass orthomosaic, and then we can see the DSM and TM.
Mm-hmm.
And after that, it's I think it's quite like 2D. And then we can put it into your
into
software. And after that,
I know there's.
I will learn more about that. It's quite.
There are groups trying to do automated analysis of 3D models, but it's a lot of work and it's not there yet. So it's kind of like now what's happening is a mix between doing the 3D, using the orthographic view, putting it in Coralnet, or there's other softwares that instead of points use polygons, for example. So that's another option, but it is combinable for sure if you have the orthographic view.
Okay, thank you very much.
Any other question from the participants? Oh, yes, you can move forward again.
First of all, thank you for letting me asking another questions. My name is Rafilas Kirtan from Maritime Science Technology. My question is more about the technical of data acquisitions, the photos and things. So do you have any advice for me so that I can train taking photos that can build more precise models? And can I train above water if I want to take if I want to train underwater?
I would say you can do that above water if you wanna, for example, do this object here. You can start with your phone and take pictures around it. So I think I showed that in the presentation, but that you had like the spiral. So you can have an object and then start taking pictures around it until you think, okay, I think I got it all. All the angles are covered. You can also, what I did at the beginning is I took pictures and I took a video and then I tried to compare what came out of it. And it's, yeah, and then you put it in the program and then you see, oh, you know, this part is not being well done. So it means that I need to put more effort into trying to. So it's a lot of trying it out and just practicing, but you can practice this workflow that I showed. You can do it with any object. So if you want to practice using the software, you can just pick an object and you will find that above water, sometimes the light reflection is a bit annoying. So if you have, I think you can see it in the table there that the light reflects. So sometimes when you're taking pictures, this light spotlight can confuse the model, but it's something that you learn and, you know, it's like, oh, I need to deal with this. So when you're underwater, you think, oh, you know, I cannot maybe, if there's a very bright reflective item here, don't put it. So it is good practice to try it above water and see how you can use a program and then just try it underwater. But it's a lot of going, trying, you come back, you see, oh, you know, this doesn't work, so I need to do it different. But my advice is just to always try to follow a pattern and feel like you're always overlapping. That's my advice for the videos.
Also, is there a rule of thumb on how, like, the minimum numbers of photo you take on the image?
There's not a number. It depends on your object. So if it's a very big one, then you need more photos to find this overlap. Of course, if you have sometimes more, it can be better, but then it takes more computer power. So there's not a number that I can give you. So it's really finding that 2/3 of overlap between images. If you can do it in 5 images, that's great, but then maybe you need more. So it's part of the train out, like how it goes with the footage that you get.
Yeah, thank you very much for your answers.
Okay, maybe the participants in Zoom meeting, is there any questions? If the participants in the Zoom meeting wants to ask questions, you can use the raise hand features first. Okay. If there's no other questions, another one from the participants in the room, you can move forward.
Yes, good afternoon. Thank you for the opportunity. Oh, I'm sorry. My name is Hafiz Mukti. I'm a student from Marine Science and Technology. So this software can convert pictures to 3D models, right? So I wanna ask question. Is it the data or the 3D models, is it valid enough to us use it for our thesis? And my second question is, what is the what we can use the 3D models for in science? That's all. Thank you.
You can use it on your thesis. I did that in my previous thesis. It really depends on your question, because sometimes it's not relevant for you to have a 3D model, but maybe it is. So if you wanna maybe look into growth rates of a colony, maybe that's something you can, instead of having a 2D view, you can try to take it to a 3D view. But yeah, you also wanna be careful into not putting everything into a model, because sometimes, is it practical? You still need computer processing. But I think it's worthwhile, like if you have a question and you wanna see, okay, how does this information is worth it in a 3D space, then you should go for it. And in the marine world, well, it's been used, you can do it with the volume of, like I did with the volume of sponges. So I took, I was validating the models. So you take the footage, then you make your model, but I was also doing measurements of the sponge in the water so that you can compare what you measure in the water with what your model does. So that's sort of projects you can maybe do. But yeah, it would always depend on your question. And sometimes maybe doing a 3D model is you're overly complicating yourself with a method, and maybe it's not necessary for your question. So you always think, do I really need to make this or not? But I think there are many possibilities where you can always try it. And yeah, thank you.
Yeah. Okay, maybe I may ask one more time if there's any participants wants to ask some questions. Okay, if there's no other questions, maybe we can finish the lectures. Thank you so much, Ms. Stephanie. Please give a applause for Ms. Stephanie. Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, those are the agendas that we have presented to you today. As we have finished our lectures, once again, we would like to say our thank you for the teams. We have Ms. Stephanie, Mr. Francisco, Ms. Adrian, and Ms. Maina in here together with us. Thank you for the insights that you have been share for us today. Before we end this meeting, maybe we can take some pictures for the documentations. Maybe we can move forward here, and all of the participants, if you want to take a step forward, you can join us also. And all of the participants in Zoom meeting, maybe you can turn on your camera, because we also will take some screenshots for the Zoom meeting participants. Okay. We can take the picture while flashing the TV. Maybe you can stand here facing the TV.
That is in here.
You sit down also.
No, here.
Yeah.
Yes.
You listen.
Okay, maybe I'll be guiding.
Okay.
On 3, 2, 1. Okay. Another post, please. Prepare your best post.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. Maybe for the last, you can make a C signs for our faculty.
Collaboration.
Yes. C for collaborations. Okay, thank you so much.
Your video.
Okay, that's all for today. Once again, I say thank you for making your time in your busy schedule to join us here. I wish you all a pleasant day. We hope to see you again soon. Here I end our agenda for today. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon, everyone.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Bye.